Thank you so much, sir. Now, without any delay, we start our first technical session on climate change impact assessment of today's conference. And I invite Professor Dr. Noor Muhammad Khan to chair this session. Dr. Noor Muhammad Khan is working as Director of Center of Excellence in Water Resource Engineering and also performing his duty as a professor in Civil Engineering Department, UET Lahore. Please, sir.
Thank you very much for inviting me. Before I start this first technical session, I would like to invite everybody, if somebody has comments or suggestions on the inaugural sessions, we can take a couple of questions regarding inaugural session. And I am thankful to Shahid Saab and Habib Saab and Minister for Irrigation Mohsin Saab for their valuable speeches in the inaugural session. Habib Saab has shown us a good presentation on how to improve the water recharge, and Shahid Saab has given us the overall picture of the development scenarios of the country and how the development will be carried out. I will request through this forum to the WAPDA managers that you should not be doing only management. Please include sustainable management in your all the policy documents. That message should be at least conveyed to the water management in the water managers in the WAPDA. So if we have no further comments, we start the first technical session. I have list of six presentation over here in addition to a keynote speech by Dr. Mohsin Hafeez. Brief introduction of Dr. Mohsin Hafeez. For me, the main introduction for him is he is our alumni, and he is also part of our some of the committees at center, and he has very candid opinions and huge contribution towards the development of the center. Dr. Mohsin Hafeez is a country representative at International Water Management Institute and has an outstanding professional, scientific, industry, research and management background experience of more than 25 years. Dr. Mohsin's significant achievement and innovations in describing the hydrology of data sparse irrigation systems were recognized by CRCIF Leadership Award in System Harmonization in 2010. He is a recipient of the Best Irrigation and Drainage Paper Award from the Journal of Irrigation and Drainage, a well-reputed journal, in 2008. He is recipient of the CSIRO Chairman's Gold Medal for Research Achievement in Irrigation Water Management in 2007. The team Land and Water Eureka Prize for Water Research and Innovation in 2007, and the CRCIF Award, which I already mentioned. I'm grateful to you, sir. So please give us your valuable thoughts on sustainable water resources management.
Thank you, Professor Noor Saab. And I would like to say also thank you to the Minister Laghari Saab, and then the Dr. Professor Habib Saab and the other people. As we are talking today about the sustainable water management, I thought within the context of that one, try to highlight the role of the digital innovation in developing the climate resilient tool, which could guide us about how what we are doing on the current irrigation practices or water management practices and leading toward the sustainable water management. When we are looking around at the global aspect, looking around the future, what are the global challenges over the next 10 to 15 years or the 20 years? First and important thing is basically the food security. There is an increase in global food demand. Production need to be increased 60 to 100% by 2050. And we are having the same water sources. What will that happen? That we need to think about that one. What exactly is happening? We need to be thinking about more efficient way of producing the footprints of the irrigated agriculture, but producing a more crop with less water. And then also at the same time that the water is available and conserving the ecosystem is important. When we are looking around, the other important thing is that the climate change, the climate is one of the known facts there, and that will be impacting on the people. And by 2050, either the climate, the flood or drought, under around 150 million people will be displaced. And what will be the impact there? So that's another important thing, how we could develop the tools and technology to mitigate those impacts which will be impacted by the climate change. Third important thing is that the societies wherever we are living is around 24 to 700 million people will be displaced by 2030 due to water scarcity. In some arid and semi-arid places are there, and that the growth or the whatever the planning we are doing, that will not be sustainable, that will not be inclusive. So we need to think about that one, how we will overcome about the inequalities within the system. To overcome those global challenges, IMI thought about we have three strategic areas, research programs. One is the food, how we could improve the food security, conserve ecosystem and water resources. Second is about climate, adapt to and mitigate to climate change. Third is building resilience to societal disruption. And third is important thing is growth. Promote sustainable growth. So growth should not be only growth for the sake of growth, but sustainable growth and how that could be balanced the gender equality and the inclusive society. Within that one, I think the important thing is if you go in a traditional way, that we will never achieve those targets. So IMI has a mission is about that one, a water secure world. And that's where the important thing, digital innovation, innovation will play a large role there. And today I will be highlighting more on that one. Other important thing is governance and equality is also another important thing. And then the economic and incentive. How we'll make sure that we are partnering with the different societies, we are partnering with all the stakeholders to develop a more resilient solution and then leading towards the water secure world. As we have the three strategic programs, we try to map on the how those are linking with the different sustainable development goals by 2030 and all of our plans and everything, except that the two, one industry, innovation and infrastructure, most of the our strategic research programs are directly aligned with the sustainable development goals. Somewhere it's 100% contributing, somewhere there are the different thematic areas are contributing to different programs. So based on that one, we have it. We are not doing its research for the sake of research. We want to do the applied research for the development. And then what that means that whatever the research we are doing, it that search should be applicable and picked up by any of the development agency to be upscaled and to be applied in the real world. And that's where we have developed three thematic, basically three research programs. One is water, food and ecosystem. And then under that one, we are looking around sustainable and resilient food production system is another research group within that one. Other is on sustainable water infrastructure and ecosystem. Not worrying only about the gray infrastructure or the hardware, but what we can do on the nature-based solution, like Professor Habib mentioned about the artificial recharge, many aquifer recharge, and those sort of things to harmonize the thing. Then the integrated basin and aquifer management, how we could improve on that one. Second is water climate change and resilience, where we are looking around climate change adaptation and resilience. And then the other is water risk to the development and resilience. Then the third is water growth and inclusion, where we are looking around then the again that the circular economy, again that the triple R, which Dr. Noorsav, you were mentioning again, how that's impacting there. And overall, how we are working within the societies and governance and those things. But important cross-cutting is water and digital innovation. We will not be able to do sustainable water management until we know how much water is available, where is the water used, and how much is used, what's our demand. Once we have that information, then we will be able to develop more sustainable water management practices and identify where are the hotspots, where we need to reduce the water losses and how to improve the water system there. And today I will be focusing on the digital innovation technologies and everything. Let me give you some examples. 90% of all natural disasters are water related. When we are talking about climate change, is either on the one extreme or the flood or the drought. All those are impacting a lot. And then I will not go into the statistics, but many of the million people are affected every year due to the flood, due to all that one. And then we are also having many billions of dollars are lost every year around the globe on due to flood or drought. And those are the extreme realities. So IMI has developed a framework on water risk and disaster. So it's important there for that one is first we need to identify the risk. We need to see looking around historical hazard data. What was the last 30 years, 40 years, the time cycle, what was the issue there, and then analyze and the changing the hazard trend for flood or for anything in that one. And also looking around that one, what are the assets were exposed and what are the vulnerability based on the historical trends and there, and that will help us in quantifying the risk. The third important, once we quantify the risk, then we need to think about the risk reduction. For risk reduction is important, the preparedness, not any haphazard, but long-term planning. How we are planning there, the early warning system, emergency planning and response capacities, and how this thing could be integrated there. Once we have that one, then we'll be thinking about mitigation and prevention. medium to long term goals, and as well as on the building the resilient infrastructure, whether it's irrigation, it's water, it's about the society, the cities, whatever we are thinking about. And once we know that one, then we need to think about that one, the risk transfer. How we will reduce the risk transfer and the vulnerable communities, how we could transfer the risk on that from there. That could be on the insurances there, whether risk management, and also on the other emerging products are there. But these technical products will only work if we will link up with the governance, policy, and institutional arrangement there. If we will not link up, then nothing would work, because it will become only the hypothetical thing there. And then important is within the government sectors, within the civil society, how we could make sure that it's capacity building, gender and youth and inclusiveness is a part of that one. And that's where we, IMI as a knowledge institute, want to develop a knowledge product and advisory services. And I will show you in the next slide how what we are doing it. So other important thing is the big data. Now in the last 20 years, there are more. We were going for agriculture extension services through typical way, but now through the tools and technology, we need to think about the remote sensing. We need to think about the smart tech, mobile phone, ground truthing, obviously that need to be done. And then the remote sensing, whether satellite imagery or the drone, how that could be used, everything together, and then including the communities, institution partner, and that will give us a different indicators there. It will give us the hazard and risk management. It will also provide us a flood and drought management and all those sort of things. Then that will give us the idea. So we need to think about how we could utilize those ones, but obviously checking on the ground and making sure that whatever we are getting, that one, that's a robustness there. Some areas will be, again, talking about the future. Some area will be more hair sharing, the example of South Asia. Drought will be 70% of the land will be affected in the next couple of, in the next 10 to 15 years. There will be floods, there will be cyclones, and then the heat waves, coastal salinity, and many of the climate vulnerability issues are there. And that will leading toward the food insecurity and also improving the, leading to increasing the poverty. How will come up on that one? And I will be sharing some of the example. Here we have developed that the based on the remote sensing, some of the products which we have been sharing within the different operational agencies in case of India, in case of Sri Lanka, in case of Nepal, in case of Bangladesh. And that's not talking only about the one thing, but also flood, drought, landslide, coastal inundation, cyclone, forest fire, earthquakes, extreme rainfall, and heat wave. Those are the operational product which we are embedding it within the operational agencies. In Sri Lanka, we have successful example. In India, we have successful example. And as the IMI country representative for Pakistan, I will be extending those products for Pakistan in the next coming years. Looking around, then the also we have a very robust products on the scaling South Asia drought management system, which is our drought resilience initiative, which has been successfully applied in Asia, and now that is extending to Africa. And that's here showing the example where IMI is working on IMI Water Secure Africa initiative. And again, that in Afghanistan, we are providing the support to the Afghanistan Ministry on the drought early warning system for the part of Afghanistan through the World Bank assistance. And also the knowledge product and those tools which we are developing it, how those tools could be applied locally, owned by the local one, because IMI interest is not to develop, IMI interest is how we are developing the knowledge product and that transfer to that the to the different institute, to the research institutes in Pakistan and to the operational agencies, so that they will utilize those knowledge and everything in day-to-day activities. Moving to the Pakistan, I think if I summarize that the Dr. Noor Saab and then as well as Mohsen Laghari Saab, the first and fundamental issue in Pakistan is we are looking around the isolated silo approach. No offense, but WAPDA is only worrying about their own issues. Irrigation department is only worrying about their own issues. And then the agriculture department is only worrying about their own. Until we go for holistic approach and come out from the silo mentality, which is a mindset there, and think about integrated aspect, that's how we will be able to go on the sustainable water sources management. And that's where not going into the issues and challenge. We know those challenges for the last 30 and 40 years, but the important three key challenges, holistic perspective, looking on the big picture. What are the multi-sectoral water demands and things that there? Do we have the data available? Third is important, from the evidence-based information, how we'll develop the policies or the knowledge product which could improve the policy. So these are the three key take-home messages. Now here sharing the example, holistic perspective. Typically, each institute is worrying about their own pieces of the puzzle. They don't look around that one, what's happening in the big picture, in the holistic system or a big picture thing. But important thing is talking from the Shiok towards the downstream Kotri, all are part and parcel linking together. As WAPDA has developed the plan for the dam, it need to be integrated. Also the other aspect there, how different user and consumer and everything is integrated together there. And that's same applicable for every other institute. When we are looking on the big picture thing from a, okay, these are the tools and everything, all is linking. If you make an upstream impact there, that will have a downstream impact towards the Kotri barrage. And we need to think about innovative solutions, because whatever we are making the changes, the deforestation in the upstream in the Gilgit-Baltistan area, that will have a downstream impact. Now, fortunate enough, in this 21st century, we have the tools and technology, digital innovation, we have the satellite, we have remote sensing, and we could get all the information there, and that we could develop a bit more holistic perspective there. Moving to giving some of the example, what IMEI is doing it here, I'm today only focusing on the digital innovation technologies, nothing about the other such work. One is about the Indus telemetry for near real-time flow monitoring in Indus Basin. Mohsen Lagari sahab mentioned about that the dispute between the provinces, which we have well known, we have set up the Indus Water Apportionment Accord, but still the biggest problem is whatever the knowledge which we are generating it, the information, that information is not accepted to the other province. There is a trust deficit, there is a, and also on a information is not trustworthy. And so therefore the IMEI has developed some of the tools and technology in partnership with the Pakistan Council of Research and Water Sources. And I will here giving some of the example. And the work is funded now previously by FCDO, British government, now it's funded by the USAID. When we are looking around the national water policy, that's clearly mandated that by end of 2021, we need to have a telemetric monitoring system to maintain and to transparent water accounting system to check the increased trend of unaccounted water for the Indus system of the rivers. And this task should be completed by 2021. So yes, there are different practices have been done, but again, for the provincial water distribution, we are still having a major issue on that one. The stigma is there that no province is trusting on the second province. So we have developed on delivering the national water policy. So we have been working in 2017 onward, basically how we'll work into the developing the Indus, basically that the telemetry system over a period of time. And then that's a journey started in 2017. And now we have partnering with the USAID a bit more on the focus on the KP province under water management for enhanced productivity. But that has, I will explain in the future slide. We are now, Punjab Irrigation Department is on board, KP Irrigation Department is on board. And then so we are working on that one. So what that means, basically it's the Indus telemetry with the world journey, which was started in 2017. So we installed the four basically that the telemetry system at four set check canals in each province and each located lower Bari Dwab canal in Punjab, where we have it, which is taking around 9% share of the Punjab. It's getting the flow and it's overall around 98% the data is secured and every day it's restored, and every day around 9 a.m. the information is available as a SMS message, how much is flow there. Kirsar Canal in Balochistan, again, that's getting around 20% share of the Balochistan. Patfeeder Canal, 50% share of Balochistan. And Upper Sawat Canal, 27% share of the KP. But what we have done, we have used the information technology, combining the depth of water measured by the ultrasonic sensor and the flow velocity monitors. And then that's going to the data loggers and everything, and that data processing is the GSM system. And every day we are getting around 9 a.m. What's the information, what happened over the last 24 hours. Then further upscaling that one through the USAID project, we have upscaled to the all the 13 canals, which are the 10 canals, which are the strategic tier one canals in KP, which is telling us how much water is available within the KP province for the provincial water distribution. So these are the canals. We are getting the information on a daily basis. And on the message, we are getting the SMS message or WhatsApp message every day. Who want to subscribe, then they are getting the message what's happening on that one. And also the other information you could get in a handy reports and all sort of things that there, what's the product there, what are the knowledge there. And again, it's not only for that one, but also we have installed, okay, you could look around that one, what's the, how is the canal performing and everything is there. Now moving quickly on the other things. Remote sensing data, especially if talking for Pakistan. when we are talking about the remote sensing, it's providing the top down, providing the technical tools and solutions, but at high level thing. The other thing is at the bottom of approach, which is end user, the farmer, the decision makers who are sitting there, dam operation, basin authorities, Hydromet. But what the middleware is that there is a need of connection between the top down with the bottom up approach. And once that's there, that will help us to improve the solution. And that's where the Digital Earth could provide the solution. We are working in Africa, but we want to applying it again in Pakistan. And that's where the decision makers want to know how the top down and bottom up approach are working together. Because the data is important, but how the data is connected with the decision. We have a raw data, we have analyzed the data, application and models. But on the other hand side, on the right hand side, we need to think about decision. And the stakeholders need to be included, deliberation and everything. Stakeholders should have a trust, whatever the data is product, whatever the research product from Center of Excellence is generated, that has the application and that's helping in decision making. And that's how the decision ready information will be available. Sharing some of the example for the industry, the annual evapotranspiration modeling, which we are looking around the whole industry for the annual product from 2015 to 2019. I will not go into the details into the modeling, but this is for the whole industry showing it. This is a part of the industry which is showing it that there is a high variation there on an annual basis from 1 year to the other year, showing again that the climate is changing. When we are looking around the monthly anomalies, again, monthly one, again, that varies a lot. You could easily see that when the wet, the summer and then the winter season and how the ET variation is varying and everything. Unfortunately, still in Pakistan or many part of the developing world, we are still relying on a single point reference evapotranspiration, which is good enough for that the individual field. But when we are looking for the water sources planning, we need to move around from a traditional that the point-based ET towards the actual evapotranspiration, but make sure that this is linked, this is validated with the ground data, whatever we have available. Looking around the groundwater, again, the important thing is that we have a piezometer network, which is excellently working very well, but over the last 20 years, due to lack of the financial resources, due to many issues, we are not able to well maintain there. But now there are great satellites are available, which is again a high level picture of thing. I'm not saying you replace everything with the GRASAR with the remote sensing. You do something, but for the system level, you could utilize some of those tools. And we checked on that one. That's showing that the trend over the period of 2002 to 2016, over 14 years period of time, getting a confidence for the Indus, whether the GRASE is providing some realistic estimate or not. Yes, it's a very coarse resolution, but it's giving us the trends when we are looking around aggregate of all that one, the data. Moving quickly to the land use and what's happening on the canal command area. And here, that's the industry part of Pakistan for showing it the canal command land use, the land cover information. What's happening there? Again, we utilize the hybrid techniques to estimate on that one. Moving to this, the now to the small canal command in Hakra canal command in 2007 to 2012, which work was done by Usman Khalid Aman and other people, where we looked around the land use and land cover, how these changes are happening on a from a one cropping season from Kharif and Rabi to the over a period of 5 years, a period of time. At the same time, that's giving us the idea instead of getting a one information, but how these are varying from a year to year, and that giving us a bit more info. That could be linked up to, again with this the Abhiyana collection. Those sort of the tools, the government of Punjab has really developed e-Abhiyana, but how that could be linking with the new set of tools and technology. I'm aware of PMIU is doing some of the remote sensing work, but that thing need to be linked up with the Abhiyana. Again, showing it the actual evapotranspiration modeling, the same trends are there, how these things are changing over a period of time at a canal command. But now I will move on quickly on the last three slides, unleashing the potential of the open data. We have a huge open source of the data set are available. That's giving us a lot of information. I will not go into the considering the time, but that gives us a bit more information. And we are not talking about development of new model, but how we could utilize the open source of the data available in our decision making. Just giving you one example for disaster resilience, we have the Earth observation. We need to analyze the data. We have a products available. And those products have been developed in western part of the world. I was involved in Australia. We have developed many of these products for the, and then we don't need to develop a new models, but how we could pick up those models from a GitHub and other models and basically tailored according to our local condition, calibrate and all sort of things that could guide us information and decision making and developing a bit more on a, how we, then that will help us in developing a resilient initiative, whether we are developing the new societies, housing societies or anything there. The last thing is how technologies are guiding the future climate risk. Yeah, even we are talking about the hazard, space technologies, forecast and early warning, flood inundation, that's where that could play a role. Vulnerability, assistance in hazard-proofing housing infrastructure, which Habib Sa was mentioning, insurance solutions, social protection, exposures, flood adaptation, flood mitigation. In summary, I will say that one, the problem which in Pakistan is that's quite complex. We need to really think about that one. We need to be including in all our planning for future infrastructure planning, climate risk assessment is must. All the PC1, which the government is approving everything, the climate risk assessment need to be strengthened there. The other important thing, linking the research outcome, whatever the knowledge research outcome are there, that need to be linking directly fitting towards the water policy. Let's say if one master student MAR there, which has been picked up about that, the what are the best techniques there, how irrigation department could embed into their decision making for the managed aquifer recharge wherever they're rolling out, obviously with the caveats around it depending on the area and all sort of things are there. Scientific evidence-based solutions are the must thing. At the moment, our most of the policies are not based on the scientific evidence base, and that should be made for a key for future investment there. Then the holistic picture is there. Then the important thing is that the problem which we are dealing with, no institute is able to resolve the alone. It's need to be partnership with the, between the knowledge partners, between the government stakeholders, between the consulting firm, with the government organization and everything. Through this platform, I'm offering that the option to the research institute primarily, that IMI as the institute will be happy to host the postgraduate student on a case-to-case basis, and they could working on IMI project to getting some of the real world problems and everything, and they and then they, we could also provide some of the financial support for them to do the activities. And that's where I'm saying we need to work together how we could strengthen back to the last thing. And thing, Professor Noosab, thank you very much. And to me, I'm the alumni of the Center of Excellence. This institute has helped me a lot, learning a lot, and helped me in my professional career building. And I will be happy to assist whatever I could do, pay back to this institute who helped me in building my own career. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mohsin Hafeez, for your elaborate presentation, highlighting the work done by IMI in Pakistan and in the region. Hopefully, the about 100 participants present at the moment and the leaders of the water resources management, they have got the scene of the use of the modern techniques for betterment of our water management. We can use these remote sensing techniques and the modeling approaches which are practiced in IMI. And I am happy to tell that my students are also learning these things and they are applying these things on a smaller scale basis. When they go to the field, they are given the knowledge of such remote sensing and GIS-based techniques of modeling the nature. Thank you very much. I will not ask for questions at the moment. I hope there may be some comments, maybe at the end of the this session, we will get some questions. Thank you.